Gold-minded records, they're not your friends.
Welcome to Horror Headquarters, a weekly horror podcast. I'm your host, Clive Craven, with my lovely co-host,
Naya Banks.
We are here to bring you the best in all things horror. News, reviews, updates, interactive polls, discussions, interviews, and more. Stay tuned and stick around as we take on the horror genre. From the rotting graves of zombies to the blood-soaked fangs of vampires. From the claws of the werewolf to the vision of the apparition. Prepare for the slaughter orders. This is Horror Headquarters. We're just dying to talk horror. What up, people? Welcome to the first episode of Horror Headquarters. I am your host, Clive Craven, along with my lovely co-host.
It's Naya, guys.
What is going on, everybody? I hope everybody out there is having a great day. This is dropping on Halloween, so happy Halloween to all my fucking ghouls and ghosts and fiends and freaks.
Woo!
That's right. Enjoy your Halloween. Be safe. Don't get too trashed out there. Try to keep it safe, guys and gals. Anyway, moving along for these festivities of the evening, tonight's main topic of discussion, our vital organs discussion, will revolve around the Reanimator trilogy. So if you've been following us on Facebook at Horror Headquarters, you already know that that was the topic for tonight for the main discussion. We will be talking about Reanimator from 1985, directed by Stuart Gordon, Bride of Reanimator from 1989, directed by Brian Usna, and Beyond Reanimator from 2003, also directed by Brian Usna. I am hoping that I'm saying that name correct. Probably fucking not, but that's all good. It's all good. So we're going to go ahead and get into some basics before we go any further into the show. I want to give a little brief introduction to us for all you listeners out there. I know you guys have been following us. Some of you have been following us in our Facebook group and already know who we are. But for those that don't, we're going to introduce ourselves. I am Clive Craven, and I can be found on Facebook at Clive Craven. And you can find our lovely host,
Naya Banks. That's my Facebook name. That's my regular name. Whatever.
Boom. Add us up. Follow us. Make sure you follow our group on Facebook also at Horror Headquarters. So with that being said, let's go ahead and get into some basic stuff about us as what we like in the genre of horror. So as far as favorite directors, for me, I'm going to roll with John Carpenter. I am a huge fan of Carpenter from Halloween, Christine, Big Trouble in Little China. I mean, you name it. The movie list is endless. They Live is one of my absolute favorites. Just so many great classics and amazing scores to go with them. You know, John Carpenter does a lot of the scoring for his own films, and that to me is just brilliant and amazing. And you know, a true ode to real talent. The guy is just simply amazing. And yeah, John Carpenter for me all the way. What about for you?
I'm going to have to say Wes Craven, because his horror movies are based off of personal experiences. Example, Nightmare on Elm Street, which is based on a personal experience that he's had, which is kind of interesting. It's nice to know stories about the director's personal life sometimes.
Yeah, definitely. Nightmare on Elm Street, for those that don't know, she mentioned that it was based on a real-life experience. When he was a kid, he actually had a burnt vagrant, staring into his house and through a window, and he saw this man and looked down at him, and they made eye contact. He went back in the house, looked back out the window again. The guy was pressed up against the window, just glaring at him, and it terrified little Wes Craven as a kid and gave him the inspiration for the Freddy character later on down the road. So I definitely think that's a very cool...
and creepy.
Yeah, very cool and creepy little story and segue about A Nightmare on Elm Street. So... moving on from our favorite directors, favorite subgenre, for me, I'm going to go with slashers, and if I'm going to get more particular, 1980s slashers, you know, things like The Prowler, Maniac, Mother's Day, you know, My Bloody Valentine, The Burning. There's so many absolutely phenomenal slashers of that era and just well done horror films. And I love the soundtracks, the setting, the atmosphere. You know, the storylines are very similar in a lot of these slashers from that era, but I love them. I can't get enough of them. I think the practical effects and the combination of great scores and solid cohesiveness in films just in general makes for, you know, a really great period of time with those 80s slashers. So that's going to be where my vote goes as far as my favorite subgenre. What about you?
Subgenre. Anthology. I like the idea of having different stories with different plots. Sometimes, if you're lucky, it'll be one of those plots where all the stories, like, have something to do with each other at the end.
Coincide, yeah.
That's pretty fascinating.
Yeah, you know, a lot of flicks, Creepshow, Trick or Treat, a lot of these films have wraparound stories that go around the whole film, but also a lot of them have interconnecting stories. I believe it was Cat's Eye was one that had a lot of interconnecting ones, and a few other ones where they do different stories that all still connect in some way or another, and that is very cool when they do that. The classic style of anthology is also enjoyable where it's just random stories, but it's also very cool when they all connect. I do like that as well myself, yeah. Personally. So as far as our favorite horror films, this is just our top three favorite, and this was just off the top, but I'm going to have to say, for me, Day of the Dead, number one. George Romero, just absolutely brilliant. I was lucky enough to meet the man before he passed away. Rest in peace, Mr. Romero. I was lucky enough to meet him at a con, and, you know, it was just a real experience for me. He signed my Creepshow, my Day of the Dead, and I have Dawn of the Dead as well. I got three films signed by him. Really nice guy, super polite, and what a legend of a filmmaker. Just so many great films in his arsenal, but Day of the Dead is one of my tops. Another one of my favorites is Return of the Living Dead. Just one of the greatest horror comedies ever. And I do feel it's more horror than comedy, but it has the greatest, I feel, elements of horror being jolted into, greatest elements of comedy being jolted into a horror film that I've personally ever seen. So I think Return of the Living Dead is absolutely amazing. I know there's people that dislike it, but me personally, I think it's an absolute gem. I really do enjoy it. And for my third favorite horror film, I'm going to go with the original Creepshow. You know, once again, another Romero and Stephen King collaboration that is just absolutely brilliant. I love all the stories. There's not one of them that I dislike. Father's Day and The Crate are probably my two favorite. Something to Tide You Over is another great one. Just really well done. Awesome stories. Great settings. Amazing lighting, too, which is something I'll talk about later when we dive into Suspiria. But I feel that maybe Creepshow was perhaps inspired by Suspiria with the lighting techniques that they used in Creepshow, because there's a lot of that two-tone lighting with the pinks and the blues and the bright hues being used, and it really, really looks good. But yeah, Creepshow, Day of the Dead, and Return of the Living Dead. And I'm referring to the original Day of the Dead for anybody listening, not the fucking horribly disfigured remake by Steve Miner that was a fucking bastard child to the series that is just embarrassing. And I like Steve Miner, don't get me wrong. I like him as a director, but I don't know what the fuck he was doing with that flick. It's bad. I think it has Nick Cannon in it, if I remember correctly. I think it has Mina Suvari and Nick Cannon, if I remember correctly. But yeah, so those are my favorite three. What are your favorite three horror films?
My favorite three. Well, my first one is Tales from the Dark Side. I mentioned I like anthology movies, and that's one of my favorites. My favorite story, though, has to be the one with the old man. I don't think he ever left his house, or his sister bought a cat into the house, fed it, and whatnot, and then at the end, the cat ended up killing the man, living inside of his stomach. I don't know how long, but that was... anyway.
Yeah, that story is pretty cool. And you know what's funny? The actor that plays the old man in that, I don't remember the guy's name, but he actually plays in a Tales from the Crypt episode where he plays a very similar character where he keeps getting these operations and these surgeries to replace body parts of his with a much younger body part. And he ends up switching all these body parts with this young guy to get this girl. And then the guy at the end that he switches body parts with, who has all his old body parts now, ends up getting the girl because he's a millionaire and has all the money that the guy paid him. So, like, it's a great twist. But I've always equated those two together just because of that little backstory. But, yeah, continue on. So, what are your other two favorite?
I'm going to have to say Child's Play for my second one. My very first horror movie I watched at the age of 4, and it was Child's Play. It was the first movie I've ever seen. That's what got me interested. My mom even bought me a Chucky doll, which was even creepier because Chucky freaked me out.
Yeah, that's awesome. Yeah, and you know, Chucky's one of my favorite... Well, Child's Play is one of my favorite franchises, too. I think they've been very consistent over the years, and I haven't seen the new one yet, Cult of Chucky, but I want to see that. Mm-hmm. I know we both want to see that. Yeah. I've seen all the other ones, but I haven't seen Cult. I know it's on Netflix, but it's the cut version. I want to see the uncut, so I'm holding out for that. So what's your last pick for your favorite three?
Obviously, Wes Craven is my favorite director. One of his most favorite movies, or...
One of your favorite movies.
One of my favorite movies. one of his favorite, Nightmare on Elm Street.
Yeah, Nightmare on Elm Street. So what do you like about Nightmare on Elm Street for you?
Freddy. Yeah. He kills in dreams, which is creepy, because you have to go to sleep, which is your most vulnerable time, obviously. His stupid-ass puns. Like, he has the most, like... Yeah.
He is cheesy. He's super cheesy. He is. He definitely is. But I like that about him. It makes him kind of stand out as having wisecracks and being one of the only goofy kind of killers. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Okay, so we went over our favorite directors, our favorite subgenres, and our favorite horror films. So we're going to go ahead and get into our next segment. This is Clive Craven and
Nia Banks
reporting live from Horror Headquarters. Our news department is making a killing to bring you the latest
bone-breaking news.
And we are back. We are here with the bone-breaking news for this week. And the first thing we're going to go ahead and talk about is the Friday the 13th video game. Yeah, now... this is available now on PC, Xbox One, and PS4 for physical copy. It dropped on Friday the 13th this month, so it just came out a couple weeks ago. And I have not had the chance to play this damn game yet. I have seen a bunch of people playing it. I have a bunch of friends playing it. I have an Xbox One. I'm a huge horror fan, and I fucking don't own it yet. Something is wrong here.
Obviously.
I need to get my hands on this game. I'm fiending to play it. I love the kills. I love the gameplay from what I've seen. I love that they've got Manfredini doing the soundtrack. They got Kane Hodder doing the body movements. Sean S. Cunningham's backing the project as well. I mean, they've really went all out and got a lot of the original cast to get involved with this. And I think it's just absolutely amazing. I believe Savini was involved in the film, in the game. So they're doing absolutely amazing things with this, and I'm really amped for it. I do want to get my hands on it and play it. I know it's been out for a little while now as far as a digital download.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm sure that a lot of people have played it, but yeah, the Friday the 13th video game is absolutely dope. I really need to get that.
Yeah, I've seen some gameplay like on YouTube and whatnot. The graphics are incredible. Like,
Yeah. I know they just added in the weather as well, which really makes me want to try it more. Like the addition of having rain coming down and the thunderstorms and just, you know, that's just fucking awesome to me.
Setting the atmosphere.
Yeah, I was just going to say it adds a lot of atmosphere to it. So yeah, Friday the 13th, the video game's coming out soon. Definitely got to check that. Next thing here is Wrong Turn 7 at the End of the Road is the working title for it right now. Apparently this is in production right now. No release date yet, unfortunately.
Womp womp.
Womp womp. But I am looking forward to it. I am a fan of the other Wrong Turn films. I've seen the first five. I've not caught the last one yet, part 6.
Yeah.
But I own the first five and I've seen the first five. I definitely enjoy them. There is moments where it gets a bit corny, whatever. But that's expected, you know what I mean? It's not exactly a big budget film, but I do enjoy the Wrong Turn franchise. I do feel the first one is the best one, but I do enjoy the franchise as a whole. So I am looking forward to Wrong Turn, this new one. I don't know how many they're going to keep going with. This film, I think the first one came out in like 2001 or 2002 or some shit, so they haven't even been out that long, maybe like 15, 16 years, and they've got seven films in the franchise, roughly one every 2 years. So, I mean, they do power them out. I give them that. Not as quite as quickly as the Saw films, but they definitely, you know, they get them movies out quick as hell. So, yeah, Wrong Turn 7, definitely looking forward to that.
Yep.
The next thing I have here is something I'm super excited to talk about.
As am I.
And that is Death House.
Mm.
Now, we've discussed this amongst ourselves about this amazing cast. You have Kane Hodder and Tony Todd and, you know, just Felissa Rose, just this amazing cast. I think PJ Souls is in it. It's just a crazy big cast of the greatest horror actors. I mean, you're basically talking an Expendables of horror here is basically what it is. And the film, I also believe, is either written or directed by Tobe Hooper, who's also a legendary director behind this film. And there was also rumors of Robert Englund being in it.
Yeah.
But I read that he withdrew, or there's two things I read. I read one article that said he withdrew from the role, and another one that said he never got the script. Mm. So there's no telling what really happened there, but I think it is unfortunate that Robert Englund, one of the biggest, you know, horror icons of all time, you know, who played Freddy, is not going to be in this film that's represented by the rest of the icons of that era.
I don't think we'll ever get the, like, real answer until it actually comes out.
Yeah, it probably won't, and I get that between casting and, you know, just, you know, agents wanting to do their thing. I totally get that, a confidentiality thing. They probably won't speak on it until after the film comes out, but I am curious what happened there. But Death House looks super fun and interesting, so I'm really looking forward to that one. The next thing on here and the last thing for our news tonight is going to be 48 Meters Down by Johan Roberts, who is supposed to direct the sequel, who originally directed the first film, 47 Meters Down, which is a very fun shark flick that we both recently watched and enjoyed, with a very satisfying kill at the end of the film. But I definitely enjoyed the movie and thought it was fun, and it's definitely a suspense, you know, a suspenseful kind of flick. But I like those movies. I like horror movies with sharks in them as well. I'm a huge fan of all those, like The Reef and Shark Night, Jaws, all things with, you know, sharks in them, I'm a huge fan of. So 48 Meters Down is something that's definitely on my radar that I am interested in checking out for sure.
The first one had me cringing. I already have a fear of, like, deep sea diving, and, like, just seeing that is like, this is why I don't go swimming.
Yeah.
Black people don't go swimming. Like, no.
Yeah, I definitely think that they love to, you know, make films that play on people's fear. Nature fear, you know what I mean? Natural fear, not just monsters, but things that can really happen. And I think that sometimes makes for the best horror films, period, because it can happen. The potential and possibility for it to happen is actually there.
Mm-hmm.
So that about wraps up this segment of Bone Breaking News. We're going to go ahead and keep it moving. We actually have our main segment coming up, which we are very excited to get into. Go ahead and get your Cheetos and nachos and drinks and dranks and whatever you need, and come back quick, because we're going to get into this next segment just in a second.
And now, Horror Headquarters presents your feature presentation, Vital Organs Discussion.
And we are back. Welcome to the segment of the show that we call Vital Organs Discussion. This is essentially the meat and bones of the show. Tonight we're talking about the Reanimator trilogy, a very fun trilogy of flicks, and I have some notes here about the films. Now, the first thing here is that they're actually based on the 1922 short story Herbert West, Reanimator, by H.P. Lovecraft. Now, I did not know this at all until I started doing some studying and prodding on the films, and I thought it was absolutely dope. I'm, you know, a huge fan of Lovecraft, and I think that basing, you know, a horror film in modern times off of his stuff is always a great idea, but I did not know that the Reanimator film was based off of one of his short stories, so I think that's super cool. Just a neat little fact and tidbit. Especially for anybody that is a Lovecraft fan out there, which there is a ton of them in the horror genre.
Did you know that two of the unproduced sequels of the Reanimator series. One is called Island of Reanimator, which is the island of Dr. Moreau. Is that how you say it?
Monroe, yeah. Dollar to Dr. Monroe.
Monroe, okay. And the better known House of Reanimator, which would have featured Dr. Herbert West reanimating the President of the United States.
That's fucking totally bugged out.
Yeah.
I had actually heard of the island of Reanimator, but I'd never heard about the House of Reanimator, which is pretty interesting. I read that as well. That was a very cool factoid about the franchise. It would have been great to see him go that way and do something really wild like that. And I have a feeling that we might see Jeffrey Combs back in that role again. I personally would like it. I know there's been a lot of spinoff ideas and things of that nature, so that's always very cool. Speaking of spinoffs, I know that in 91 and 92, Adventure Comics, a division of Malibu, released two miniseries related to the film. Now, these miniseries were basically spinoffs, and I believe there was also a prequel series that predated the Reanimator story that gave the origins of Dr. West, which is also very cool. So I would like to get my hands on those comics. I do have a few horror comics and do think they're very cool, so it would be nice to get my hands on those.
Definitely. Musicals. I know you guys are a fan of those. there was a Reanimator musical. It was a stage play based on the cult classic film Reanimator, obviously, which was adapted from the stories of H.P. Lovecraft. The first one was performed in 2011 at the Steve Allen Theater in Los Angeles, California. Also awarded one of the best musicals in L.A. Weekly, which is pretty fascinating.
Yeah, that is pretty crazy. And it's wild that it would get awarded as one of the best musicals, it being a horror-themed musical. You know, that's very interesting to me because, let's face it, the horror genre doesn't get a lot of love. A lot of people shun it and push it away. It is the bastard son of, the bastard child of film. It definitely is. It's the second time I've used bastard son. I'm sorry if all the bastard sons out there. I apologize. I am totally shitting on bastard sons. But yeah, that's pretty wild that there was a musical to it. And also, according to Reanimator Resurrectus, the 70-minute featurette on the limited edition 2-disc box set, the glow stick was used for the glowing green reagent, and it was the first time that a glow stick, liquid or glow sticks, had been used in a film ever. So I thought that was pretty cool use of an odd item like that to be pulled into a film. And also, you know, pretty simple, you know, when you think about it, like what they could have used. I always thought it was something much more complex than that. I always thought it was something more than just glow stick liquid. I never even thought of that, and it makes sense. It's such a basic tool to use to get a glowing color out of it, so it totally makes sense. Earlier this year, we both had the pleasure mm-hmm. of actually meeting the man himself, Jeffrey Combs, Dr. Herbert West, the Reanimator, in the flesh.
Yep.
And it was an awesome experience. He was a super friendly guy, very cool. Didn't ask him a lot. Asked him what it was like working with Ricky from Trailer Park Boys on Would You Rather. And he said he was actually a very quiet guy, very nice guy, soft-spoken. And that kind of surprised me, for Ricky, you know what I mean? Anybody that's familiar with the Trailer Park Boys show. So, very cool meeting him. This was at Monster Mania 37, which was in Cherry Hill, New Jersey. And he signed my copy of Reanimator, my Blu-ray. And it was super dope meeting him. You know, I even called him Dr. West when I first met him. And he snickered at it and thought it was funny. So, it's really cool going to cons and meeting these celebs and, you know, being a part of that horror culture in person. It's one of the funnest things to do. So, meeting him at the Monster Mania was a very, very cool experience.
Indeed. In fact, before going to Monster Mania, I haven't even seen The Reanimator. The first movie I seen him in was Would You Rather, actually.
Yep.
And that's what I known him from until, you know, James told me. Yeah. He's from this. I'm like, oh, Okay, yeah. We need to watch it. Yeah,
Reanimator is one of my favorites, so I definitely had to turn you on to that. It's an absolute classic. So, also here, we have some video game references, which I noted down that was pretty cool. There's an online Flash game called D-Animator, and it's based on H.P. Lovecraft's original character. So, that is pretty interesting that... You know, they did a spinoff of that on a Flash game, you know, which obviously is modernized to show that culture of that film and that cult following is still there and thriving.
Yeah. The Splatterhouse video game series features a mad scientist called Dr. Henry West. Close enough. Owner of the West Mansion.
That's awesome.
Yeah. The setting was for the series. This Dr. West was also constructing experiments, resurrecting the dead. Which is also similar to the movie, obviously.
Yeah, that's great. That's super cool. Splatterhouse I'm actually familiar with. That's an old school game. I wonder if that's the newer version or the old OG. Either way, that is a super cool fact. I know West is a main character in the Japanese video game Operation Darkness, a World War II era tactical RPG / third-person shooter about an allied special forces unit that possesses supernatural abilities. And West is the team medic. So, yeah, that's pretty wild. The English version of the game, West is renamed Herbert East. So, that's super funny. Yeah, I thought that was funny.
In the video game Obscure 2, the player picks up a key card in the hospital belonging to a man named Herbert West.
That's cool. So, just a little ode, tip of the hat to him there with the name. In the Endless Runner game Zombie Tsunami, the player at one point unlocks a potion called Herbert West Finest Reanimation Serum. That is super wild. I love that so many games have adopted using themes from the movie in their game. That is really cool to me.
Yeah, I've never knew that, actually. So, that's pretty interesting. In the video game series Sherlock Holmes, The Devil's Daughter, a pamphlet? Yeah, promoting Bedlam Asylum states to contact Dr. Herbert West for questions.
Yeah, so, even with a game where they're, basing it on another popular franchise like Holmes, they're even still referencing West. So that just shows you how deep the cultural roots are for this film. And that is just fucking cool to me. What I mean? That it's so ingrained into the culture that even video games are making references to it. And that just shows how far that franchise has rooted itself into pop culture, period.
Yeah.
So that pretty much wraps up the notes on the films as a whole. We're going to go ahead and start talking about the films themselves now. Yeah. So the first film, Reanimator, the original, 1985. Directed by the legendary Stuart Gordon. Just an absolute classic flick. I'm going to go over some cool facts before we talk about the movie itself. So, first off, Richard Band went over schedule by 2 days while composing the score in Rome, Italy. As a direct result of this, he had to invest $1,500 of his own money in order to finish the score.
Oh, bro.
Yeah, so I'm assuming at the time... 1500 was a lot more than it is now. Obviously, this is over 20 years ago, over 30 years ago. So, obviously, things have changed a bit with economy, and the dollar is not worth quite... Well, yeah, it's basically plummeted, but inflation and the value of the dollar has changed. So, obviously, $1,500 at that point in time was quite a bit more than it is now. But I thought that was pretty interesting. Richard Band, obviously, is a pretty notorious character in the horror cinema world because a lot of the deals that he does at Full Moon and the things that he puts out, a lot of people hate on. So he's quite a notorious character, so I'm sure a lot of people chuckled at the fact that he had to pay a little bit of his own money to do this. But I thought it was a very cool fact.
Yeah. Did you know that the opening theme borrows heavily from Alfred Hitchcock's Psycho from 1960, his opening theme by Bernard Herrmann, which is pretty awesome. And I've never seen the movie, actually, so...
it's sad. I've never actually seen the whole original Psycho myself. I have the original on VHS. I have all of them on VHS, and I have part 2, 3, 4 in the remake on DVD. But I've only seen parts of Psycho, unbelievably. I have such a huge collection and seen a ton of horror films, but I have not seen the iconic original Psycho in its entirety. Only parts. So don't feel bad. I know that's blasphemous, and I'm sure people's heads are probably spinning out there in horror land, but yeah, I haven't seen it either, so I can't say much to it. But interesting fact to go along with that, the opening credit sequence pays visual homage to Saul Bass's work in Hitchcock's Vertigo from 1958. So another tip of the hat to Hitchcock as well. So I think it's safe to say that Stuart Gordon is likely a Hitchcock fan, which is totally understandable.
So I read that Jeffrey Combs, Barbara Crampton, Robert Sampson, and director Stuart Gordon visited an insane asylum and a morgue during their preparation for this film. I wouldn't have done that.
No, that's actually really cool. And yeah. a lot of directors and actors will do shit like that when they prep for a film to kind of put them into it a little bit more and give them that feel of what the actor would be feeling and how they would, you know, project themselves and the type of way that they would carry themselves from being in that specific type of environment. So
yeah.
I think that's really cool that they did that, though. And one, as far as going to a morgue to actually get prepped for the film, that is very cool. The Dr. Herbert West reanimates in the opening scene. The doctor that Herbert West reanimates in the opening scene is named Hans Gruber, which is the name of the villain in Die Hard, released 3 years after this movie. So that's really cool that they gave a little tip of the hat to Reanimator. I think that's a really cool little segue. And you know, that's cool too, because Die Hard is such a fun classic action film.
I've never seen it.
Die Hard is so good. But yeah, Die Hard references the film, so I think that's pretty cool.
I'm an animal lover. And knowing that an actual cat, dead cat, was used for the refrigerator scene.
Little Rufus.
As Rufus, yeah.
Little Rufus.
It was heartbreaking, honestly.
Poor little Rufus. Yeah, that scene is pretty brutal. Just all the scenes with the cat are just savage when he reanimates it and brings it back. So the knowing that they used a legit one in the fridge is pretty fucking grimy. And also, there was originally a subplot that revealed that Dr. Hill had the ability to control minds. And it was cut from the film for timing reasons, but evidence of it can still be seen in the story. He's seen performing that skill on both Megan and Herbert, and is the reason that he's able to control the zombies in the film's climax. So it gives explanation and reasoning to how he does that and why he does that, but that's pretty fucking bugged out.
Yeah. So originally, Stuart Gordon wanted this to be a stage production, and then later a half-hour television pilot. So the television script was revised to become a feature film. Film in Hollywood on an estimated budget of $900,000.
Which ain't shit.
The film originally received an X rating and was later edited to obtain an R rating for video rental stores.
That is pretty interesting. I did not know that it had an X rating. I'm not exactly even sure what was required for a film to get an X rating back in the day. I was under the impression that an X rating was considered pornography, and I don't think there's anything in the film that could be technically considered pornography, yeah. So I'm not sure where the X rating came with that, but that's definitely interesting. I know that originally, director Stuart Gordon also wanted to shoot the movie in black and white on 16mm film to give a more gritty quality to the flick, so that's pretty wild, and I would like to actually see it in black and white myself, which you can easily do just by adjusting your TV or whatever, to see what it would look like in black and white, just for my own personal sake.
I'd want to see it in black and white with the serum glowing as green. The way
that would be dope, and that's very reminiscent of like Human Centipede 2, where it was just the shit scene was the only thing of color. The brown and the shit was the only color scene through the whole black and white movie. So, yeah, Reanimator is just a really fun flick. I personally love it myself, a huge fan of it. You know, Jeffrey Combs is a great actor. I've seen him in a bunch of different flicks, and there's nothing that I've been disappointed with thus far. He nails the character. He stays consistent as the character through all three films, too. They're portrayed great. Just really solid acting, and just a stone face actor too when it comes to it. You know, he says his lines with such seriousness behind him that even though it's jokey, it still comes off as very creepy and eerie. So I definitely appreciate the Reanimator flick, and you know, I love the series to bits. So Reanimator for me is just, you know, absolute top notch. You know, the story is great too. It's just a really fun story, and it's told well. And Stuart Gordon is a great director. He brings a lot to the film. And obviously the soundtrack is great. You've got, you know, a band doing his thing and just creating another classic horror soundtrack, nodding to Psycho, and, you know, just a real gem of you know, horror films in general. So we're going to go ahead and get into the second film, Bride of Reanimator from 1989, directed by Brian Usna. And this one here is very fun. They brought back Dr. Kane, which I love. I like Dr. Kane's character. So they brought him back again. And now we have Reanimator basically trying to bring a woman back to life out of various body parts and tissue and whatnot.
Yeah, stolen from the morgue, right?
And and making almost, you know, a female Frankenstein, you know, a Bride of Frankenstein, you know, pretty much. Which is, you know, kind of the concept, I guess, with Bride of Reanimator, a tip of the hat to that. So that's very cool. But I really like this one. I feel like, it went a little bit further with the flying bat head, and it was a little bit more outrageous, but I really liked it. I enjoyed it, and I think they amped up a lot of things on it. I don't think it's quite as good as the original, but it is a solid flick and a good entry in the series, and I'm definitely a fan of the direction that they took with it and you know, the homages that they paid tribute to with it. I think it definitely succeeds in what they were trying to do with it, and I definitely think that it is a fun horror film, which
I definitely agree.
Yeah, it succeeds in that 100%. So some fun facts about Bride of Reanimator. One thing that I thought was pretty dope is at one point, Dr. West suggests that the noises coming from his laboratory wall are just probably rats in the wall, which is a reference to one of H.P. Lovecraft's better-known stories, Rats in the Wall. So once again, you know, another homage and tribute paid to the legendary H.P. Lovecraft once again in this franchise. So as you go through, you notice that there's constant references to it. So I assume that Usna, also the director, was also a fan of H.P. Lovecraft, much like Stuart Gordon was the director of the original. So that was pretty cool.
I agree. I didn't know this, but a sequence was planned in the original script where the head of Dr. Hill was found in an attraction at a carnival, probably in the freak section. It's mentioned in the film, but is never shown. So I would have loved to see that, honestly.
So they keep you guessing, but they don't show you. So I like that. I love when they do that in a horror film, when they tease to something being a certain way, but they don't necessarily show it. They allude to something being, you know, set in stone, but it's not exactly the way it seems. And that's always cool. And you don't always have to show things either if you're trying to display horror. Sometimes not showing things can be scarier than actually showing things. So I definitely enjoy when they do that. So also, at the end of Reanimator, Dr. Hill's head was crushed, and the eyes were totally gouged out, and the head was thrown against the wall. However, in Bride, the head is all but fully restored, with no additional damage apart from still being separated from his body.
Yeah.
So you've got this, you know, severed head with the eyes still intact, however they were completely crushed and the skull was gouged at the end of the first film. So a little bit of a continuity issue there. This doesn't really match up from the first to the second as far as the look, but that is something that is pretty interesting to note in between watching the films.
Yeah, so boom, hashtag fun fact, keeping it trendy. When Dr. Graves was talking to Dr. Hill's head, there was a knock at the door. Dr. Graves goes and hides the serum in the metal pan and covers it with a towel. When he goes back to talk to Dr. Hill, the serum is back to Dr. Hill's head. Well, not back, but, you know, next to it.
Next to, yeah.
And then it disappears again. You can also see the glow from the serum in the metal pan holding Dr. Hill's head, obviously, which is even though the serum is not in the shot.
Yeah, so that's pretty crazy. So you can tell that basically they once again had a continuity issue and things didn't match up with where they had actually placed things in the movie versus where it was shot in the next scene in the mm-hmm. sequence. Yeah. So the continuity issues are pretty common, but it is always cool to notice them and pick them out. Especially in horror films, I like to pick up things like that. So, once again, very cool. Bride of Reanimator for me is definitely enjoyable. I like the direction that they took with the franchise and, you know, like I said, tipping the hat to Bride of Frankenstein and having this idea of bringing a female to life and making her out of parts. And then also bringing back Dr. Kane again, and Dr. Hill, too. They're both back and I think that's really cool that they kept that continuity going there. And for me, you know, that always is a big thing in a sequel for a film, you know, for a horror film, is having the original characters come back and reprise their roles, because that is essential to continuity and keeping it, you know, in your head, keeping it to the same story and not separating it as something else. At least for me, that's how it is. It's easier to go from story to story when you have the same characters versus the actors changing. So Bride of Reanimator for me definitely gets a thumbs up. I don't know what your thoughts are on it.
Ratings 9 out of 10 definitely. I like the first one better though.
9 out of 10, that is heavy.
Yeah.
That is a heavy hitter. I like the first one better as well. Definitely do prefer the original. If I was going to put a number on this one, I didn't put a number on the first one. The first one I'd put it probably a good 8.85. This one I'd probably give a strong 7. I'd probably give a strong 7 to this. I enjoyed it. I don't think it was as good as the original, but it is definitely a strong entry into the series and an enjoyable flick for sure. I don't really have a whole lot more to say about Bride. I'm going to go ahead and pull us right into the next one, which is going to go ahead and be the last one of the franchise, and that is Beyond Reanimator from 2003, also directed by Brian Usna, who directed Bride of Reanimator as well. This one here is a very interesting take on things, and it's definitely enjoyable. One of the things that I like about it is the prison setting. And the modernization of it, it's obviously a lot more updated than the other ones because it did come out in 2003. The effects are a little bit cleaner. I don't recall any CGI being used. I believe everything was practical as well. So the effects are solid in it. Directing is solid. You have Brian Usna helming it again. You've got Jeffrey Combs back again as Dr. Herbert West, the reanimator. There is no Dr. Kane, unfortunately. I do not believe Dr. Hill appears in it. It's a whole different film. It's definitely updated and has a different vibe than the first two. But it once again, it is fun and it does deliver. I do like it. It's definitely my lowest of the three and doesn't have quite the same cohesive vibe as the first two. But it is definitely a fun flick indeed and definitely a solid watch. I would definitely say it's worth a watch. I wouldn't say that it's necessarily one that you would have to have in your collection if you're not a huge fan of it. But I like it. You know, it's a solid film for me. I think it's the lowest rated out of the three, personally. I think they do get worse as they go along, but worse is not necessarily the best term because I like all three. Even the third one I do like. But we have some interesting facts here about this one. So number three is also the only installment, Beyond Reanimator, is the only installment of the Reanimator series not filmed in the United States. It was actually entirely shot in Spain, which is interesting. And that's pretty notable, too, because you can tell with the actors in it, if you remember, there's definitely some what looks like dubbing and, voice acting going on with some of the actors involved, which is fine. I'm not one of those people that are fretted from dubs or even subtitles. Like, that doesn't bother me in a film, so it's fine to see that. It's just something to take note of that I noticed when I was watching the film, that there was definitely some points where
it was definitely noticeable.
It was dubbed. It was clearly dubbed. But yeah, definitely interesting that it was, you know, filmed in Spain.
Okay, so Howard Phillips, played by Jason Barry. Okay, and again, this fact came up several times. This movie is based on a story by H.P. Lovecraft, whose full name is Howard Phillips Lovecraft. I didn't know that. That's pretty cool.
Mm-hmm.
Also, the last name of Elsa Patekai, hopefully I'm saying it right, her character is Anni, which is the last name of the main character, Thomas Anni, in Lovecraft's story, The Strange High House in the Mists.
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
I don't think I've ever seen that.
No, it's a story, I believe, just a book.
Oh, okay.
But it's interesting that there is, once again, another reference to H.P. Lovecraft again in the third film. So it's, you know, a really cool reiteration that the third time, you know what I mean? The third time it's been included in the film. So every single film has at least one H.P. Lovecraft reference to it. So that's pretty neat that throughout the franchise they repeatedly touch on that. I think that's very interesting. And I also know near the end of the movie, when the legless corpse is getting down from the ceiling to attack Dr. West, the shadow of the actor's legs can be seen on the wall to the left. So, yeah, there was obviously, once again, another continuity error there in making sure that the shadows and all didn't show up, which that can happen in the best of films. It's just a simple oversight, but it kind of kills the effect if you're trying to have a legless character and you see the shadow of their legs in the scene. It kind of kills the effect there just a little bit.
Just a little.
But, yeah, that was something that I thought was pretty interesting.
And I didn't know when Emily searched the house for the strange noise, like right before being surprised by her brother, she crosses in the living room. A cameraman is visible in the large wall mirror for the entire tracking shot. Boom.
Yeah, so, yeah, like we were talking about, it's so easy for these things to happen in these films and for them to get caught up in, you know, just making a good film and not necessarily paying attention to little continuity things. And a lot of shit gets slipped by in films. You'd be surprised how many simple slip-ups, ironically, I fuck up as I say that, how many simple slip-ups there are in film where you don't even notice it unless you really research the film, because they're small things. You know, you don't, as the viewer watching it, you're typically not going to notice unless you're paying super attention to every little detail, or if you research the film and look into it, or watch, you know, features on it or whatever, something to clue you in on what actually did happen or, you know, could have happened. But yeah, that's pretty much the notes that we have for Beyond Reanimator. Like I said, this for me is probably the weakest of the three in the series. I would probably give this, if I'm being 100% honest, probably a 5.5, maybe a 6. Maybe, yeah, I could probably give it a 6.
Yeah, same here.
It's good. It's not as good as Bride. It's definitely not as good as Reanimator, obviously. But it holds its own. It's fun. It's modernized. It gives a new spin on things. Different setting. It's a little refreshing to get a different kind of setting and vibe. I do enjoy it. Might not be for everybody. It's still, like I said, Brian Usna does it. He's very true to staying to non-CGI effects for the most part. So you do get a lot of practical effects in there. So it's not been butchered with bad CGI. So definitely check that out. I do recommend it. It is a fun flick. I recommend the whole franchise as a whole. All three of these films are super duper enjoyable to me. There's not one that I don't like. They're all super fun. They all bring something different to the franchise. And, you know, like I said, the most important thing is they're fun.
Yeah.
You know, there's something you can curl up with your girl and watch. There's something you can have company over with and have a fucking nerd night and just watch some creepy fucking weirdo horror movies. Like, they're enjoyable. And that, for me, is one of the most important things. Yeah, that it's a fun, enjoyable flick, because I don't care necessarily if it's scary. It doesn't have to scare me. Horror movies necessarily don't exactly scare me. I'm just interested in the story and how it's done, and like them done in a horror vibe. You know what I mean? There is horror films that can be scary and terrifying. I don't think Reanimator sets out to terrify, but it tells a great story, and it's done in a fun way, and it has a great cast, and you know, I seriously did enjoy all three of the films. I'm glad we were able to go back and revisit them, and together. And it was just, you know, a fun experience going through those movies. What is your overall final thoughts on the Reanimator franchise / trilogy as a whole?
I definitely liked it. I enjoyed it. It was my first time, as I said earlier. So, like, new movies do interest me, especially if they are enjoyable, as you said. So, like, if you're boring and, like, I haven't seen it before, like, it's gonna turn me off instantly. But definitely enjoyable. Hooked me instantly.
Yeah, they liked it. Yeah, they're fun, and they have that comedic element to all of them, and that, you know, hysterical kind of undertones that keep it from being too serious and taking itself too serious, and it just works well and bodes very well for the films as a whole. So that about wraps up our discussion on the Reanimator trilogy. We have a whole lot more coming up, so don't go nowhere. Take your bathroom break. Do whatever you have to do. We will be back in just a second with our next segment. Stick around.
What's new for you to view? Find out this week on Netflix Best Picks.
All right, we are back. And of course, this is Netflix Best Picks. And this week, we have decided to choose the film
Hush
from 2016, directed by
Mike Flanagan. It's a funny last name.
Flanagan. Flanagan. So, yeah, the movie Hush, 2016, dropped on Netflix. Really, really fun flick. I liked it. I thought it was an original premise. Essentially, you know, spoilers. Essentially, you have this deaf woman that lives alone, and she's very independent and very strong-willed, and she is stalked by a masked killer who seemingly has no rhyme or reason to his slashing ways, and he really fucks with her psychologically. It's very psychological.
Like, this movie had me on my feet. Like, I was trying to get, like, I was yelling at the TV for her to turn around like she could see me. Like, oh my God.
Yeah, it's definitely intense. And I like the direction they took with it. I think that it's a very fun home invasion type flick with a great twist. I think the killer is super savage. There's a few moments where, you know, the actions of the actors are very cringeworthy. Not in the acting, but in the actions they do, it's like, oh, why would you do that? But I guess that's in a lot of horror movies where you feel like they do something stupid or something they could have did better. But I did like this film. I think Hush is pretty cool. The plot behind it's pretty original. It is a it's a fun film, you know. It's a fun watch. I know I use that word freely. I say fun film. When I say fun, I mean that it's not like super duper dark. Like, it's definitely not light. It's not a light-hearted horror movie by any means, but it's not like a Hostel, you know what I mean? It's not like where it's just fucking brutal savagery. It's definitely a thriller, you know what I mean? It's definitely a thriller type vibe. For some reason, it kind of reminds me of the film Collector, if you're familiar with that. The plots aren't exactly the same, but for some reason, it kind of gives me that kind of vibe. Collector's another very dope flick, but Hush for me is definitely enjoyable. I would recommend it. It is our Netflix best pick for the week, so definitely check that one out if you have a Netflix account. I believe it is still streaming on there. So yeah, check that one out. Hush from 2016, directed by Mike Flanagan. And that wraps up our Netflix Best Picks segment. We're going to go ahead and keep it moving to the next one. You already know what's coming. If you don't, you're in for a treat.
The year is 2136. And all in Northern California, the zombie apocalypse has taken over. Who's left? The least likely candidate. A scavenger of the wildlands. A furred beast. You can run. You can hide. But you'll never get away.
They're attacking everyone! Run! Run for your life!
Do you hear that?
When the humans are away, the cats will play. An experience like nothing you've seen before. Clawing its way into cinemas this year. The cat's out the bag.
I'm coming in through the fucking wall!
Starring Victor Mathis and Adriana Hughes. This is...
Bloody Pussy. Pick your poison.
Boom.
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 All right, so we got to pick your poison for this week, and it's going to be the classic original Evil Dead from 1981, directed by Sam Raimi, versus Evil Dead Remake from 2013, directed by Fede Alvarez, or... one of those variations thereof, or maybe not any of those three, and I'm still completely fucking wrong. Very possible, highly likely. So this is a classic debate here for you. You got the OG original from 81, the remake from 2013. The original a little bit more comedic, the remake a little bit more dark and dense. The original, in my opinion, a little bit more life in the characters, a little more flair with the characters. The remake, a little more brutal, a little more gory. So, you know, it's interesting with these two because it comes down to what do you really prefer. The remake overkilled the gore and the blood to the fullest extent, i.e. the blood rain at the end and a lot of other scenes that, you know, really went hardcore with the gore. Which is fine, I'm not against that, but... you know, the original Evil Dead was already super gore-laden and super bloody, and I don't think it really needed the intensification. I think they could have done things to make it a little bit more extreme without adding more gore and blood. They could have made it a lot more creepy. It definitely added more of a serious element, and I think that the creature in the basement, the chick, was definitely more terrifying-looking, the updated version. But I like that original one as well. You know, it's a tough one for me with this because I do like both of them. I think Evil Dead is actually one of the better done remakes. But personally for me, I kind of feel like the original just has a little bit more soul. The characters have a little bit more life to them. You know, I am a Bruce Campbell fan, so that kind of allures me to it a little bit. I don't know. I prefer the original over the remake, personally. I enjoy them both, but if I have to choose and pick just one, I'm going to have to go with the original from 81, the Sam Raimi flick. Just very well done, perfect blend of horror and humor. It's not as intense with the humor elements as Army of Darkness or Evil Dead 2, which are both much more comedic. It's probably the most serious of the three films, actually, but the remake is a lot more serious even than that and drops a lot of the comedic elements. There's really not almost any comedy in the remake, to be honest with you. It's very limited. But it's very brutal and gory, and it's a great up-to-date adaptation. It's just, it's not going to outweigh the original for me personally. What are your thoughts on these two flicks, the original and the remake? Break down a little bit on each, thoughts on each one for me.
I definitely like the original, but I do like the remake too. I don't know. I'm kind of torn in between, honestly, because they both were good. Bruce Campbell was amazing, obviously. In the remake, the girl who played the main character, I can't remember her name. But she also played that part, especially the possession. Like, she made it terrifying.
Yeah, it was. I give her that. It was definitely a little bit more eerie. You know what I mean? A little more creepy than the original. But it just didn't... There was certain things, like, you know, they did do things a little bit better than the original in certain elements. It's just, for me, it personally fell a little bit short for measuring up to the OG. But I don't know. That's such a tough one.
Yeah, like I said, it's 50-50. I can go either way, honestly.
if you absolutely had to choose, gun to your head, what are you choosing? OG or the remake?
I'm gonna have to go with the OG.
Yeah. OG, yeah. Okay. So two to one on this. We both are taking our votes with the OG. So pick your poison this week. That is 2-0 for Evil Dead OG from 1981, directed by Sam Raimi, versus the Evil Dead remake from 2013, directed by Fede Alvarez. I apologize. Yeah, something of that nature. But, yeah, a great pick your poison for the week. What a great way to kick off the first show. You know, a real cool pairing of two flicks, originals and remakes. And we're going to be trying to do things of similar nature just for future episodes. Just keep in mind that Pick Your Poison will be two films that we choose to pit against each other that are similar in vein, whether it's a remake or even a sequel or two films with similar plots or themes or whatever. We'll be pitting two films against each other every week and basically telling you which one we prefer, and why, and what we like or dislike about each one. So make sure you stay tuned for the rest of the show, because it is not over yet. We have much more coming. We still have two more segments flying your way, so don't go nowhere. We'll be back after this.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5. The bodies are starting to add up. Body count reviews.
Okay, we are back once again, and we have body count reviews, as you already know. We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 films on the lineup tonight for you, all very different backgrounds, very different subgenres of horror films, all of these. Very, very, very interesting blend of flicks. So we're going to go ahead and get into the first one here, which is going to be I, Madman from 1989, directed by, I'm going to butcher the fuck out of this,
yeah.
Tibor Tekas? I think that's what it is. Let's hope that's what it is. We're going to pretend that's what it is because I don't fucking know. That's my best pronunciation. This shit is not easy, folks. Don't you fucking judge me. I see you sitting in your chair judging me.
Stop it.
Stop judging me. Okay. Anyway, so first film we have here, I, Madman, like I said, from 1989. This is a very fun slasher that has a very interesting premise. This film basically is a chick that is, you know, reading a novel, and the character is actually coming into her life. The character she's reading about in this book is actually alive. And he is killing people, and she's witnessing it and seeing it. And as the killings happen, the writings happen to correspond with it in the book, and that's kind of how it all spirals out of control.
No, I think what it is that all the kills that are happening are based off the book, because she goes back and helps the police get there before, but nobody wants to believe her.
That's true.
Yeah.
That is true. And that's definitely another way to look at it, and probably a more accurate way to look at it. that's a good point. I didn't even think of it that way. But it's just either way, the whole plot line of being stalked by something that you're reading about is very interesting to me. It definitely makes it terrifying for people that are readers.
Yeah.
And a lot of people that are readers are cerebral thinkers and, you know, and are horror fans. You know, a lot of people that are most cerebral are actually horror fans. And it's ironic to me that they use that as a kind of device in the movie, to portray that. And I think that's very cool.
Thought it was pretty cool myself, yeah.
Yeah, but, you know, I, Madman is a super fun flick. I love the look of the killer, too, with, you know, the face being veiled and the hat that he rocks and just the cloaked look. It reminds me of, like, The Shadow or Darkman, that kind of, like, suited villain type of look. Really cool and interesting. But yeah, I, Madman is definitely a super fun flick. I would recommend it. Check it out if you haven't. It's fun. I mean, I don't know what else to say about it. I think that if you're into slashers of the 80s, it's at the tail end from 89, but it very much so lives up to that quality with, you know, no fucking CGI and interesting score and just fun. It's just a really fun horror movie. And this one really truly is fun in the sense that it does have some comedic elements, and even the soundtrack alludes to that a little bit, but this one is definitely highly recommended by me. I don't know about you, but I enjoyed this
one. I do recommend it, definitely. If you're into, like, working your imagination in a way, I definitely recommend it.
Yeah, it's definitely one that gets you thinking, because there's a lot of ways that it can be interpreted with the way that the story is told. You know what I mean? Like I said, because you and me both had different ways of viewing it. We watched the same movie together, and we viewed it a little differently. So it's definitely open for interpretation, which is really cool. The next film for Body Count Reviews is going to be Poltergeist. Now, this is an absolute classic from 1982, directed by the late, great, legendary Tobe Hooper, famously known as the director of Texas Chainsaw Massacre. Now, Poltergeist, I've seen 100 times. I had recently just revisited it for the show, and I gotta say, it's refreshing to go back to every time. It is an enjoyable watch. I do think that it's probably a little overhyped, to be honest. It is. It gets a little more hyped than what it really is, but it's a good film. It is solid. The soundtrack is super creepy, and I talk about soundtracks a lot because I make music, and that's just what I do. So I sample a lot of horror music, so the music always stands out to me. But the theme for Carol Ann in that is absolutely just horrifying, and it's just, it's so creepy. You know what I mean? Creepy more than horrifying. You know, I think creepy is a much better word actually suited for it, but the soundtrack in that is awesome. The theme is just great. You know, I just enjoy it all around. I like the fact that the ghost, like, fucks with them. The poltergeist, rather, fucks with them and really starts making them question their sanity. And you can visibly see the dad and the family getting more, like, distressed to the movie. I don't know if you noticed that, but, like, as the movie goes on, he definitely looks more, like, aged and haggard and just, like, he's not giving a fuck. Like, he's not shaving and shit.
You can see the depression.
Like, yeah, it's sinking deep into his face. But yeah, Poltergeist is just a really, really great one. I, you know, highly recommend it. If you haven't seen it, check it out. I don't know if you had, I don't know how you could have not seen it if you're a horror fan, but there is people out there that, you know, I haven't seen Psycho, so I can't shit on anybody for not seeing Poltergeist. But if you haven't seen Poltergeist, you haven't got around to it, definitely check that one out. One thing I forgot to do is give a rating to these films. So we're going to go back to iMadman just for a tick and smack a rating on that. iMadman, I'm going to go ahead and give a strong 6.5 to, a very strong 6.5, almost a 7. What are you going to give it?
I'll have to give it a 7.5 maybe. It definitely was a good movie, but, yeah.
Yeah, I think that there was things that it could have been improved on for sure, but it's one of my favorites just because of the story and the plot twist, and it's just, it's a really fun one. So, Poltergeist, back to Poltergeist now. We're going to go ahead and smack a rating on that one. For me, I'm going to go ahead and give Poltergeist a solid 8. Maybe a 7.5 to 8, actually. A 7.5 to 8. Like I said, it's good, but it's not great.
Yeah. And we just watched this movie again, or he just watched it again last week, and it was my first time seeing the original. I did see the remake last year, though, so I guess I did it backwards. My apologies, whatever. But
which is funny, because I haven't seen the remake yet.
Yeah, yeah, so definitely going to have to show you that. But I'm going to have to give it 7.5, 8 myself. I did like it, but I do like the remake more. Don't hate me.
Oh, my. I can already feel the hate looming onto you for this one. Wow. I'm not even going to say anything.
Shall we?
I'm not going to say anything because I already know that the comment section's going to fucking blow up and everyone's head's going to fucking explode off of their torso when they hear that.
Sorry.
So, to each their own. Everybody likes certain things, so there's nothing wrong with liking what you like. I'm not going to knock you or anybody for liking certain films. I haven't seen it, so I can't shit on it either, but I've heard terrible things about it, so that's what I'm basing it off of. Moving on, we're going to go ahead and get into the next one, which is a classic. It is enjoyable. I love it. Seen it before several times. One of my favorites. Love the whole trilogy. This is an absolute classic, though. Suspiria from 1977, directed by the legendary and still living, thankfully, Dario Argento. Absolute masterpiece of a film. Amazing score and soundtrack by Goblin. Phenomenal lighting. Great atmosphere, awesome kills. I love the coven idea. I love the concept to it. I think the acting's solid. You can totally look past the dubbing and the voice acting. Like, it's nothing to look past that at all. It's just really, really well done. It all the way around. I honestly can't think of anything about Suspiria that I dislike. Like, truthfully.
Again, my first time seeing it ever. But I definitely did like the lighting. Like, my favorite color is purple, one of them at least, and the brightness of the red and the blues definitely combined and made a purple, which was my favorite because it made the movie, like, more dramatic than, like, anybody else would have viewed it. You know what I mean?
Yeah, adding those type of lighting techniques and cinematography definitely highlights the film and makes it a standout from a lot of films of that era. I think that's honestly one of the things that most people remember about Suspiria is the lighting in the film. Mm-hmm. You know, it's absolutely amazing. And the kills are great. And the score, like I said, that spine-tingling Goblin intro with the bell, you know, intro is just fucking grimy sounding and it stands out. So Suspiria for me is going to be way up there. I'm going to throw Suspiria probably a 9 to a 9.25. It's definitely like a 9, 9.25. It's way up there for me. There's not anything I can think of really that I dislike about it. I'm sure there could be probably some cohesion to it a little bit more with certain little elements, but nothing that's groundbreakingly to make it stand out. So, I'm going to go high with my rating on that. So 9 to 9.25 for Suspiria.
I'm going to give it an 8, but 8 overall, but the lighting is definitely, like, off the charts, like I said, but...
Yeah, the lighting is amazing. 8's a respectable number. I mean, that's a high rating, and like I said, ratings are totally subjective. It's to the viewer and the person watching, so everybody's gonna have different views and opinions on each one. That brings us to our next one, which is actually the follow-up to Suspiria, and we watched all these in the same week. We did the whole Suspiria trilogy. This is the second one in the trilogy, which is Inferno from 1980, also directed by the legendary Dario Argento. And this one also has the same lighting technique, is a follow-up to Suspiria, which also follows the Three Mothers story of this coven of witches that, you know, had these books that tell their stories and has them scattered throughout different areas, and they're all buried underneath the houses of where the witches reside. Mm-hmm. Which I think is a fucking brilliant idea, and is also super creepy. Like, the idea of having these witches in, like, big areas like Rome and fucking New York and all these, like, famous spots, and having them have homes where they're legitimately having these covens and these, you know, witchcraft rituals is terrifying because it can be real. You know what I mean? There is real witch cults out there. There is real cults out there. And witches in the sense of non-traditional witches. I'm not talking about a witch that you see in a movie. I'm talking about legit spellbook witches that actually cast black magic and do different spells and shit, like Wiccans. And Wiccan isn't necessarily black magic, but there is Wiccan witches that, you know, practice magic. And it's a common practice. So it's interesting because it's relatable and real. But Inferno really nails it again out of the park. I don't think it's as good as Suspiria, but it is definitely up there for me. I really liked it. I thought the scene where she walks in with the book and, you know, she's trying to get information on it, and the dude grabs her, that whole scene in the boiler room with the laboratory, that shit is so grimy.
That creeped me out.
Yeah. It just, that whole chase scene, and I think all the chase scenes in that movie are so well done. Like, I love that. Mm-hmm. I really love it. And it's very cat and mouse style and back and forth with the killer and the victim. And that's the type of shit that I really like. So Inferno for me is awesome. Great follow-up to Suspiria. If I'm going to go ahead and put a rating on that one, I'm going to go ahead and give that a strong 8 to probably 8.25. It's not quite as good as Suspiria, but it is phenomenal and a great follow-up. Well done lighting. Awesome directing by Argento again. This one just really is another knockout of the park for Argento once again. What are you going to go with for a rating on Inferno?
I think I'm going to go one lower and give it a 7. Like you said, not as good as the first one, but it was definitely good, like, out there.
Yeah, it's a solid film. Definitely a good sequel. I just don't feel like it lives up to the original. But I can't name many sequels that do live up to the original, so it's whatever with that. That brings us to the next one, which is going to be My Bloody Valentine OG from 1981, directed by George Mihalka. Now, this is another one that I am a huge fan of. It's one of my favorite slashers of all time. I love that whole era of 80s slashers, so this is one of my tops. Just really well done. Awesome, awesome killer. I just love the idea of a killer minor. And this is the first film that really nailed it for me. This may not be the first killer minor movie, but it's the first one that really nailed that concept and was just fun. Like, it's a really cool one. The kills in it are very brutal. The dryer kill, the heart rips, you know what I mean? Just the pickaxe. I mean, the kills are savage, like, straight up. I mean, they're fucking brutal, especially for that era. 1981 was a very touchy time in horror. Things hadn't quite gotten to the point to where you could get away with everything, but films like Cannibal Holocaust had just come out and, you know, really pushed the limits. So directors at this point were doing what they could to really go to the next level, and they without were, because My Bloody Valentine pushes the limits with some of the kills and being very grimy and very gory and, you know, just over the top. But I like that about it. I mean, personally for me, My Bloody Valentine is an absolute classic.
As we watch this, like, I remember, like, you know how you remember certain parts from a movie and whatnot from when you watched it. I didn't think I've seen this before, but I did remember some parts. But I remember it being shown on, like, TMC or some movie channel.
I swear to God, it had to be TNT or TBS. And it was probably TNT Monster Vision back in the day with Joe Bob Briggs, which was the shit.
I think it was IFC, honestly, because that's a... They do IFC, uncut movies and stuff
IFC,
like that.
Yeah, IFC plays some good shit. But yeah, so if I'm going to rate My Bloody Valentine, I'm going to go probably a 7 to 7.5. It's a super solid film. I don't think it's worthy of an 8. But it is definitely at least a 7, 7.5 for me. What is your rating on the My Bloody Valentine OG?
Probably a 7. Valentine's Day is, like, one of my favorite, like, holidays. And I like the way they put a twist on it because, you know, anything could go wrong on a holiday. So,
yeah, I mean, everybody is out and about in town, going around. People are traveling. It's a vulnerable time. You know what I mean? Holidays are one of the most vulnerable times. I think that's why horror films based around holidays, you know, Christmas and Thanksgiving and Halloween and Valentine's Day, they're effective because people are busy. They are vulnerable. You know what I mean? Typically, horror movies are the best when you do have somebody in a vulnerable state, whether they're in the shower, in the bathroom, or sleeping, or alone, or in the dark. You know what I mean? It's always when they're in a vulnerable state. So that is at the core one of the main things that drives a horror film. So
it's like not only that, but like Valentine's Day is supposed to be like a loving holiday. Like you're supposed to show love, and it's like I think it's kind of crazy how like one heartbreak or something from your past can like make you do something like that.
Yeah, totally. He loses it. Warden totally just fucking loses it. And that's cool to me. Like, that's cool to show that twist, like a passion crime. And that's exactly what it is, a crime of passion. Mm-hmm. My Bloody Valentine OG from 81. Awesome flick. Highly recommend it. This next one we're going to get into is awesome. One of my favorites. This is going to be Killer Clowns from Outer Space from 1988. Directed by Steven Chiodo. And the Chiodo brothers, who are the ones that directed this film, are actually in progress right now of working on the return of Killer Clowns from Outer Space 3D. And I'm fucking super excited about it.
Yeah.
Really looking forward to that. But back to the original. So, Killer Clowns from Outer Space. This is a super schlocky, super fun horror movie with, you know, the most cliche clown jokes in it, but well done. And terrifying looking. The clowns in it absolutely look menacing and freakish and have this big top tent that they're living in, and they have fucking cocoons wrapped up in cotton candy that are bodies. I mean, it's just super strange. You know what I mean?
Popcorn as a weapon.
Yeah, popcorn is a fucking weapon. You're getting shot in your spine with a popcorn gun, bitch.
Boom.
Pop, pop. But just, yeah, that's just awesome.
And this was my first time seeing this film again. I'm a newbie to anything we talk about, probably. and I have a fear of clowns. I mean, these are no Pennywise, but these are some creepy-ass clowns. Like, their smiles are just really unsettling. It made me cringe. Like, yeah,
They definitely look wild, and yeah. they use the proportions to their benefit. There's some really super uber tall clowns, some really heavy set ones, and then midget clowns. So they try to use body extremities, like, you know, using extreme height, extreme shortness, and extreme weight to enhance the characters and make them more interesting and scary. And it works. It really does. They did a great job with that, and it does add a lot to the characters. So, yeah, Killer Clowns from Outer Space, super fun flick. If I was going to throw a rating on this one, I gotta be brutally honest. I can't base things on like, oh, I personally liked it. Like, it's gotta be like a rating on the film, just trying to be non-biased. So if I'm trying to be non-biased, I'm going to give it a 6. But that's like being like a strict rating on like what it would be as a film. My personal rating, I'd probably put it like a 7.75 just cause I like it so much and it's fun. But yeah, Killer Clowns from Outer Space is a fun one for me. What is your rating on that?
I like that it's corny.
It's campy.
Yeah, there you know the directors have a like sense of humor. Like,
yeah, definitely.
They're not strict and boring like some of these directors out here. So I'm gonna give it
shots fired.
So I'm gonna give it a 6.5, 7, maybe. Definitely liked it. It's not on my top, but it's out there.
Yeah, it's a good flick, and for a clown flick, and especially a comedic horror clown flick, I mean, that's kind of limiting things, but it is a super fun watch, and just a really good flick. I really like it. You know, me personally, I grew up on it. I seen it a bunch as a kid. Me and my brothers, we grew up on that one, so that for me holds a lot of personal memories, and I'm attached to it mainly because of that. The last one for body count reviews is going to be The Fun House, which is a fun flick from 1981, directed by the late, great Toby Hooper as well. This one is really kind of interesting because it's the first time that I can recall seeing a fun house used in such a way where, you know, there's like this sideshow family behind the scenes that kind of runs things and, you know, has this whole second life where they're killing people behind the scenes and kind of living out a real life fun house. You know what I mean? So I do like it. I think that the acting at some points is a little shoddy. The chick particularly, I can't remember what her name is. I think it's the blonde chick. You know, some of the times when she gets scared, she's just too much. She's too over the top with it. And just, it's just not cohesive for me. You know what I mean? She just comes off is just overbearingly just acting too much, putting a little too much flair on it for me. But overall, Funhouse is definitely a cool flick. If you're into the films that have a, you know, horror family type of premise, like it almost gives me a you know, a feeling of like Hills Have Eyes, Devil's Rejects, just because of like the mutant family, like the fucked up family. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And that's kind of cool because I like those types of films, and it definitely is kind of probably the root of where those films originated, some of those. So for me, I'm going to have to give The Funhouse a solid rating. I'm going to go ahead and give it a 7 to 7.25. I do like it. I think it's a slow burner, too. It takes a while for things to really take off in it, which I kind of do like about it. But Funhouse is a good one. What is your rating on that one?
I'm going to have to give it a 7.5. Yeah. Personally, I remember my first time going in a Funhouse. Didn't like it. I got nauseous. Fun mirrors make me nauseous. I mean, I don't need to see without, like, why am I short? Like, come on now. I don't want to be short. I like myself. No, no, when I'm short. Tall.
Oh, no.
But, yeah, they are fun. They make me nauseous. So I'd get 7.5.
That's actually happened to me. I've gotten pretty damn close to throwing up in a Funhouse before just because of the floors being uneven and shit like that and the moving floors and shit like that. So I definitely understand where you're coming from with that. And that about wraps up our review for Body Count Reviews for the week. We're going to go ahead and get into our next segment. If you need a refreshment, bathroom break to go to the patty, or there other, take that time and go. Dismatch yourself.
Wake up, kiddies. There's no time to sleep. It's time for the pool of the week.
Alright, so this week's poll of the week. What is your favorite installment of the Texas Chainsaw Massacre franchise? Either Texas Chainsaw Massacre, TCM 2, TCM 3, Leatherface, TCM 4, The Next Generation, TCM Remake, TCM The Beginning, TCM 3D, or the new Leatherface. I don't know if you've seen it. I haven't. I mean, I want to. I'm ready for it.
It is the only film out of all those that I have not seen yet. I've seen the first 7 Texas Chainsaw Massacres. Excuse me. 4, 5, 6, 7. Yeah, 7. First 7. I have not seen the new one myself yet, Leatherface. I am looking forward to it, even though it's been torn to shreds in reviews. I am definitely interested in checking it out. I do have a favorite in the franchise, but I will not tell you until next week.
Boom.
Boom, boom. When we talk about it on the show, that is one little segment that we can't do on this show because this is the first week.
Duh.
However, during next week's poll, we will give the most voted upon answer by our fans in our Facebook group. So you guys will be included in the show. So get involved. Drop your vote. I will post this in the thread. By the time you hear this, it will already be in the group. So make sure that you go to the group, drop a vote on it. I'll make it the pinned poll for the next week until we do the next show. And that's how we're going to roll with those. So make sure you guys vote in these poll of the weeks. It is important. We want your feedback. We want to know what you like, what you dislike. So please get involved with the show. Get interactive with us. Go to our Facebook page. Go to our group. Check out the poll of the week. Drop your vote. Let us know what your favorite Texas Chainsaw Massacre franchise installment and why. We appreciate that shit. Boom.
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 Boom. All right. We are going to take it into the final chapter.
Boom.
Boom, boom. This is basically the wrap-up right now, guys. This has been our first show with you. We appreciate you spending the time with us, listening to us go over everything we talked about tonight, all the interesting news stories, going through the Reanimator discussion, our Netflix best picks, your Pick Your Poison episode with the OG and the remakes of Evil Dead, the 7 reviews from Body Count, and our poll of the week, which we hope you participate in. Please go over to our Facebook and get involved with us. Make sure you tune in next week where we will have a brand new show. We do not know what we're going to do our show on yet. We will decide that tonight, and we will start preparing for the next show. We will be dropping these once a week after Halloween, after this drops on Halloween night, and all you ghouls and ghosts get a chance to vibe out with your favorite horrific host, Clive Craven, and...
me. Naya. I mean, I'm just regular old Naya.
Okay, so we appreciate you guys spending the time with us. This has been your first episode of Horror Headquarters. We hope to see you back next week. We are just dying to talk horror.
Boom.
See you soon.
Have a good night.
Boom. Have a happy and safe Halloween.
And don't get fat.
Shit. Eat the candy. Eat. Where's the baby? Eat the candy. Where's the baby? Eat the candy.